Hi everyone, thanks for joining this webinar about designing products with privacy in mind. Today what we're going to talk about is what is privacy and why is it important? How can you start thinking about privacy, designing privacy experiences, dark patterns and how to avoid them, and also how to work with cross-functional stakeholders. My name is Aurora Brigham. I'm a privacy product manager. I'm from Norway, but I live in New York City. My professional history, I currently work at Nike, but this is actually my last week. So soon I'm going to be working at Zoom and also working on privacy there. Before Nike, I was at ESPN and Disney. I'm currently taking an MBA at the University of Illinois. I also studied integrated digital media at NYU and marketing and communications at Berkeley College. I also added a link to my LinkedIn if anyone wants to connect about product management or privacy in the future. So, designing products with privacy in mind. First of all, what is privacy? Privacy is a person's rights when they use online services. Generally, privacy is broken down into three categories: communications, so you have the right to communicate freely; information, the rights you have to decide how your information is being used; and an individual privacy right, so the right to exist freely online. Why is privacy important to you? So you want to protect yourself against identity theft and cybersecurity. You also want to protect yourself against manipulation and tracking. And finally, you want to protect yourself against profiling and stereotyping, where companies use your data to give you a certain experience just based on how they think you behave and who they think you are. So why is it important for digital products? First of all, companies need to follow the law, and this is obvious. Not following the law can have consequences on if you're allowed to operate or you may have to pay really big fines. Digital privacy laws are also trending and expanding and just becoming more and more inclusive and far-reaching. So we have examples from the EU with the GDPR. We also have examples from the US, like California with the CCPA and the CPRA. And these are trends that are going to keep coming with more and more privacy laws and rules that kind of determine how digital companies need to act. So also, building privacy right can enable your digital business to do really powerful things with data. There's big opportunities to personalize user experiences and market to people using data, as long as you're using it compliantly. Building privacy right can help build trust with consumers, which can lead to just loyalty and consumers to really trust you and build that relationship with you. It can also be a competitive advantage and against all these other competitors that might offer similar services. Finally, privacy is an expectation at this point, and violators can have really devastating consequences to their brand reputation, and this can be really hard to recover from. So how to start thinking about privacy? A few questions that you can start by asking yourself: what is your business model? How do you make money? Do you actually sell data? Do you market to people? Do you communicate with people? If you say yes to any of those questions, then you need to start thinking about privacy, and those are probably good places to start, especially if you sell data as a business model. What are your brand values? So what kind of values are you setting for your brand in general, and how are those linking to your privacy values? What data are you collecting, and how are you using it, and how are you processing it? Where are you doing business? What are the laws of the geographies that you do or plan to operate in? There are situations where companies decide operating in certain geographies is just not worth it based on the privacy requirements. They might be too complicated or too specific for that region that they're worth the risk, or the foreign laws may just not align with your local values. An example of this is freedom of speech is a really strong value in the US. In some countries, governments regulate freedom of speech and ask you to moderate social content or user-generated content on your platform, and that might not be something that aligns with your company values. So, speaking of values, one really great place to start is to defining your own privacy values. What is your company mission and vision? What are your company values? This is a really great starting point to create privacy values, which will resonate with your team and also with your customers. Privacy values need to be clear, they need to be actionable, they need to hold you accountable, and you should really write them down and share them with your team. Once you define privacy values, they really need to come from the top down. Privacy risk is everywhere in the business, and if privacy values are well defined and actionable, you can really empower your team to make the right decisions. Empower employees to use critical thinking in their everyday, define roles and responsibilities with the organization, such as privacy analysts, lawyers, product managers, who's responsible for making decisions and who's responsible for informing and contributing to these decisions being made. So designing privacy experiences, what are they? What are some privacy experiences? So we have disclosures, privacy policy, terms and conditions. These are all kind of table stakes in terms of what's on digital properties online. We have consent journeys, so cookie walls and marketing opt-ins, operating system prompts. These are all journeys where we're asking users to consent to something. We have privacy settings and management, so it's important that you can empower your users to take control and actually have the right management and have the right choices so that they can get the settings that they want and continue to use your product, and also make decisions if they want to not give their privacy up anymore. Similarly, we have unsubscribe journeys. For example, from email marketing, you often see an unsubscribe journey, and this is something that's often required by the law to have a really frictionless journey so someone can opt out of marketing communications. So when it comes to building these privacy experiences, it's really important to understand who your consumer is, and this will be the key for making decisions when it comes to your design. So first of all, where are they? Jurisdictions, these are boundaries where the laws are upheld within. So normally they'll apply within country borders. Sometimes they apply within geopolitical alliances like the EU or smaller like provinces and states such as California. Different people in different places have expectations of how their privacy should be treated. So a customer in Europe might have different expectations than one in China versus one in the US, and you need to be aware and respectful of these expectations. There's also cultural differences as to what's expected, so that's something to be aware of too. Who is your customer? So what is their age? There's actually a lot of laws that apply specifically to the customer based on their age, and the Children's Online Privacy Protection Rule is an example of this that sets really strict requirements to customers who target users below the age of 13. So another thing, what is their tech maturity? How adept are they at using technology? Are they easily manipulated by digital companies? And this is something that you want to think about when you're making design decisions. So what do your customers want? This is really important to think about too. Give people benefits if you're going to use their data. People on the internet, there is a value exchange always, and data should deliver a benefit to the users. If you're asking a user to give your company their data, offer a benefit that they're actually going to want if you want them to say yes. People are also getting very suspicious of big tech and data, so if a value is offered and they don't believe in it, or they don't understand why you're asking for something and how that's going to deliver them the value, that they probably are not going to be likely to opt in. So it needs to be really kind of tangible and connected for a user to want to opt into something. So based on my own experience, these are kind of some of the privacy design principles that I've developed. So first of all, just be transparent, be open, be honest about what you're doing with data and what it's being used for, how it's being used, or else people are not going to be willing to give it up. And if it does come out that you were dishonest, that's going to be a really hard thing to recover from. Speak to people in a language they will understand, not just the right language, but use the right words. Don't bury the lead with legal jargon or tech terminology. Be respectful of a user's understanding. They don't understand how the internet works and they don't have to. So make sure that you're connecting it to what they understand. On this note, focus on outcomes for the user. Don't tell them to accept or decline something. Tell them what will happen if they accept or what will happen if they decline, and give them true choices between one or the other. Give them options. So don't bundle things together where they have to consent to a lot of things that they don't want to get one single benefit. A lot of times you'll see people opt out in those situations, and they're really then miss out on benefits that they would have wanted. Be mindful of context. So what is the user doing? What is the user journey when you're asking them for a consent or when you're asking them to make a decision about their privacy? So be really mindful of their intent and what the context is that they're doing. And the closer you can tie the benefit of giving consent or the privacy experience with the benefit that the data will deliver and asking in that right moment, the more likely you're going to get people to opt in, because the benefit can be paid off right away and it's really understood and it's based on their intent. Also, try to stay ahead of trends. Privacy laws are expanding, as I mentioned, and expectations are changing. So the moment that you fall behind and you become reactive, that's when you really put yourself in a position where you're going to make bad decisions because you don't have the time, or you're in the middle of a fire drill and you have to comply with certain regulations that you're out of compliance with. So that's not a good recipe for crafting good privacy design. So just try to be aware of trends and try to stay ahead and be proactive. So I wanted to share some examples of what I consider to be good privacy design. This one is from IKEA. So you can see here, this is when you first join IKEA, they show you a little bit of what the app has. You can save your favorites, you can access inspiration and your IKEA card. And they really demonstrate that value a little bit before asking the user to accept their terms and conditions. And I know I scrolled kind of fast, but also they break down their privacy policy. They give you access to articles about how you can control your data, benefits of sharing data, and how they protect your data. And these are all things that people want to know. And they break those down so they're easy to access without having to dig through a privacy policy. Another example from IKEA as well is this contextual prompt. So I talked about context. What is the user doing? Well, in this screen, this is where they go to find inspiration for their home. And right now, you can see right here that there's a prompt that says, you know, do you want your inspiration to be personalized? And you can give access to your browse data to make this more personalized. So this uses really simple language. It's really contextual because you're in that experience and that's really where the benefit is going to be delivered. You're not forced to opt in, but it is there for you if you want to. So this is something that I think is really important to think about, is don't force a user to opt into something. Think about the experience for the user who opted in, but also think about the experience for the user who didn't, and make both of those as good as they can possibly be, because that's going to benefit your user and that's going to benefit your business, because you're really creating the best possible user experience, not a happy path and an unhappy path. Here's another example from Elevest, which is kind of like a portfolio company for women where they manage your stocks. So this has a really nice flow of adding information about what data is being asked for. I'm setting up my profile right now and they ask me for things like my gender and my income. And they give you easy access to information through that eye, where it tells you why does gender matter. And here it really explains the benefit of giving data, because it's telling me why my gender matters to the product and how this company knowing my gender is going to make my portfolio management better, which is going to make me more money because they know how women's salaries change over time versus men. So I'm happily going to give up this information because it's going to provide me a benefit. And here they're doing the same thing with my salary too. Why am I giving up this really personal information to this company? But they give me a clear reason too. So one thing I wanted to touch on that I think is really important is measuring success. And this is something that product managers do all the time. So it's really hard with privacy to measure trust. And this may be something that you need to do through more qualitative forms of analysis, like user research and conversations and surveys. When it comes to the quantitative, you may have some constraints around what data you can collect. And this is by definition. An example with cookie settings or data collection permissions is that unless you get permission, you're not allowed to collect the data. So this means that bounce rates, for example, is going to be inaccurate because you weren't allowed to collect information and they bounced. So you don't really know how many people bounced. Opt-in rates is one way that people use to measure success of privacy products. And I just want to say to be really careful about using opt-in rates as a strict kind of measure of success, because opt-in rates don't necessarily measure the intent of the user. So the way I like to look at it is, one thing is that if they opted in, but another thing is, are they actually benefiting from having opted in? Are they using the features that are tied to the consent and the benefit that they were supposed to get from consenting? Another thing is, are they regretting the choices that they made? Are they going back into their privacy settings and turning something off because they didn't enjoy it? So that might be some ways of looking at the intent from the user. Another metric is maybe bounce rate. So once you put a privacy experience in front of them, are they just leaving your product? That means you may have offended them or creeped them out, or they didn't like what they were seeing. Maybe you didn't give them enough choices. So that's one thing that you could look at if people are just leaving, if you're able to measure it. Another thing I think is good to look at is think about the long term. Think about the lifetime value of this user. We're talking about creating relationships and building trust. So look at how long is a user, how are they building their relationship with your company over time, however you may measure that, and try to tie that back to certain privacy experiences that you created or privacy settings that the user has. So I wanted to talk a little bit about dark patterns now that we've talked about measurement. So what are dark patterns? This may be a word that you've heard before. Dark patterns are basically design patterns that are aimed to manipulate or trick users into something that they don't understand or something that they don't want. These are mostly intentional misrepresentation or deceptive or unfair practices. And I say mostly intentional because there are very intentional uses to really use psychology and understanding of behavior against users, but you can also kind of accidentally create dark patterns. And I'll talk a little bit about how people accidentally, or how to avoid them, which may lead to like how you kind of create them in the first place. But dark patterns are not just unethical, they're also forbidden by the law. There are laws that explicitly call out dark patterns as illegal. And the outcome of dark patterns is that they really make users make unintended decisions or potentially harmful decisions at worst. Some examples of dark patterns. This is an example of from weekday.com, which is owned by H&M Group. But dark patterns is really going beyond just influencing customers. It's maybe creating asymmetric design where you have an opt-in button that is 3 times the size of the opt-out button, or somewhere where something is really hard to find because it's hidden behind other larger items. It can be covert. They can be restrictive. So this example that I found here, I think, is pretty restrictive. Because here, all in one, you have to opt in to getting promotions, to confirming your age. You have to consent to letting your data be processed for personalized promotions through social media, email, and SMS. So that's really a huge bundle, and it's very restrictive. I don't have a lot of choice in that matter. Hiding information is an example of a dark pattern where the information that you're looking is very fine print at the bottom, almost inaccessible to the user, or just hiding it in other ways. And also being just straight up deceptive, where you're just lying to a user or telling them something that they want to hear and then tricking them or manipulating them that way. So how can you avoid dark patterns? I think it's really important to make data-informed, not just data-driven decisions. Be careful about how you measure success, like I talked about, and be really careful with A/B testing, because A/B testing can lead you to optimize for the wrong reasons. And you can see, you know, the larger you make the opt-in button, the smaller you make the opt-out button, the more people are going to click the opt-in button, and you would continue to kind of optimize the design for these wrong reasons, and then you're not capturing the intent and you're creating dark patterns by doing that, even if you don't realize you're doing it. So I think one thing you can do is conduct qualitative research. Just ask users, observe users as they're walking through your design and see where they're stopped. Ask them questions. Did you understand what choices you made? Was that enough information? Did you understand what was being said to you? And really get their opinion and be user-centric in your approach. There's a privacy paradox, and this is something that you can often see when you're designing privacy experiences, is people say they want tools, but when you give them the tools, they don't use them. So this is something that probably means you didn't design tools in the right way, and you probably didn't ask the user at the right time for them to want to use them, because users often will choose convenience, and that's why, you know, if you don't give them choices, or if you don't give them meaningful choices or good controls, they're going to choose convenience. I don't want to read a whole privacy policy, and I'm just going to keep going. So really design for a vulnerable consumer first, and try to understand their needs and understand that they don't necessarily understand how the internet works. So finally, I wanted to talk a little bit about cross-functional partners when you're a privacy product manager. So working with privacy analysts and lawyers, this is where, you know, they are your closest partner and they have so much information that you need. Every company is different in terms of who's available to you and how many lawyers or what the scale is of that operation, but the legal team really helps you assess legal risk. Laws are open for interpretation, and you'll never find a law that tells you exactly what decision to make. Laws are written for wide use cases, and they're vague by design. So here you can see an example from the GDPR where it's not, yes, they have to be informed and specific, but that doesn't tell you exactly what to do. Your privacy team and you as a privacy product manager really find that balance between legal risk and business value that you're trying to achieve. So speaking of the business, marketing, sales, editorial teams, it may be different depending on your company, but they often own the product profit and losses of the features that you're building or the privacy features that you have in the product as a whole. And they can really be impacted by the implications of privacy. So try to do your best to understand the operational impact, and these stakeholders will be much easier to work with, and they hold the key to a lot of kind of detail that you may need. Help them understand the long-term goal of privacy and give them the information that they need to help you advocate for privacy, because then we can create something better together. Partnership. So partnership people, they manage the relationships with the marketplaces such as Google and Apple. App stores can have their completely own privacy requirements because they know people want privacy, and whether you're on the platform, whatever country you're in, these laws apply to you if you want to be there. So this is an example of this is operating system controls like push notifications, GPS location, device identifiers. And the one that you can see on the right here, the operating system requirements from iOS 14 had a huge impact on the advertising industry as a whole, where they now change the way companies can use device identifiers for attribution and personalized marketing. Other product managers kind of know how different features work, such as content management systems, product recommendations, different marketing tools, etc. And to build privacy right, you need to understand how those details work and how data flows. They may also own features that your privacy feature enables. So this is where you can really deliver value, and this is where you have opportunities to create contextual moments and think about end-to-end user experiences. You want to help them understand the user journeys that you're creating and how this impacts them and their product and kind of their roadmap. And together, you need to make privacy a priority. And one thing that I've seen is really sharing examples from both inspiration and industry, what's happening to others, is a really great tool to kind of align on a privacy vision and make privacy a priority because you really see the landscape. Finally, engineers. Engineers solve problems, and my experience is that they enjoy and thrive on difficult problems, and privacy is one of those problems. You need the developers to really be your closest partners because they also understand how things are built and are the key to be making privacy right decisions, where the devil is really in the detail. Empowering and motivating engineers to challenge you to build privacy right and understand edge cases to meet your privacy requirement is going to be your best asset. And share your privacy vision with them and bring them along and become their partner and help them advocate for you and with you. So, in conclusion, to design with privacy in mind, you really should define your privacy values from the top down, empower and reward your team for making privacy conscious decisions, understand your business and your business needs, understand who your customer is, deliver value when you ask for data, and also work with others to deliver privacy right features. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Aurora Brigham. You can find me on LinkedIn or just email me if you have any questions. Thank you.